and Justice for All is the title of the message. Look at liberty. What is liberty and what does it mean to you? Liberty, according to the dictionary, had 12 definitions, and the one I chose to expound upon is a place where certain immunities are enjoyed, where jurisdiction is exercised, a privilege that or a granted right. Liberties that we are given, and in the setting of our Pledge of Allegiance, liberty and justice for all would be the liberation from the oppression and the situations they were dealing from Britain, and the establishment of the Constitution and the rights that were given to individuals to experience and enjoy certain things. A release from. The same thing that happens at salvation. You are released from the penalty of your sin. Jesus takes care of that. The blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin, and he gives us liberty in Christ. And the Apostle Paul and Peter dwelt a lot with that. And in the book of Peter, the church is under severe persecution from the Roman authorities, and things are difficult, and times are tough. And there's a lot of emphasis on loving one another and even loving your enemies and respecting those that you disagree with and to get along with the culture in which you are placed and where you are at. And we're called to do the same thing. We're called to get along with one another. And, you know, as we have this privilege and these rights that are granted to us, and it is a duty, as you look and you turn back in your chapter, perhaps to chapter 2, verse 9, you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people. For what reason? That you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. And he goes on to what they once were and what they become. We were created to give him praise. It is what we are called to do. And as the heavens declare the glories of God, so should we. Even as I was reading in some kind of magazine or whatever it was, that the animal kingdom has ways that it gives praise. And you ever notice that as you watch them and it seems like they're giving thanks to their creator? And if the animal kingdom can do it, why can't mankind, who is created in the image of God, not give the creator praise? The only reason we won't is because we become self-sufficient and proud and arrogant and think we don't need to. But let me tell you, everything that you have, will have, or become is from God. He is the one that allows you to exist. He is the one that keeps you from perishing. He is involved in your life whether you accept him or not. He is helping us to survive, and he provides for us. Who do you think provides the harvest? Who do you think provides the ability to keep the world at the right temperature and to keep the oxygen at the right level that we don't perish? He is a God who cares for his creation. And so we have these liberties that are given to us by God. And as believers, we have no get out of jail free card or it does not apply to me card because we are believers. We have the same obligation to be civilly responsible. We have the same obligation, more, greater obligation, to love our enemies and to be kind to those that treat us wrongly. There's a higher standard for believers, to be honest about it. But we have the word liberty coming into play. It's important that we respect the institutions that we are involved with and faced with, even if we don't respect the ones in charge or those that are in authority. You still should respect their position and the office that they maintain. And the scriptures is clear about that, and it's never right for us to violate our conscience or disobey God's word. The Holy Spirit within us is given to us for a reason. He's given to us for many reasons, to illuminate the scriptures, to convict us, to guide us, to direct us. And we can have the wisdom of God. How do you get the wisdom of God? You ask him for it. James says, if you lack wisdom, ask God. Is he going to withhold it? No, he's going to dump it on you liberally, it says. If you lack wisdom, ask God and he'll give it to you. So as we look at this thing called liberty, Peter deals with it. And you know that this liberty is not a license to do your own thing. And that was a struggle. And sometimes people will take advantage of grace. And well, I'm forgiven and I've the penalty of my sins paid for, so I'll just do my own thing. No, that should not be your motivation. Your motivation should be that you love the Lord God with all your heart, your soul, your mind, your strength, and you want to do things that please Him. And he brings up the word bondservant in this passage. A bondservant was that servant who could have been released and set free to go out into the slave market again or whatever they would choose to do. But a bondservant is one that chose to stay within the household. He was not heir to the inheritance, but he was able to stay in that household for the duration of his life. And the way they marked them was they would put an earring in their ear, and they would know that that is a bondservant. He chose to be with that master. And you know what? God is a good master. He takes care of us. And to be a bondservant to Christ is not a problem. Paul learned that he will be a good shepherd. And he will lead you in places that we need to go. So we're going to look at this thing, the institution of liberty, the implementation of it, and the ideals of liberty. Verse 13 and 14 gives us the institution. There are definitely rules in place. Therefore, submit yourselves to every ordinance of man. There are things that are established, and there are guidelines that we need to go by. Aren't you glad that there are rules in the line of traffic and driving? It's just not, well, you can do what you want to do. If you want to experience that, go to some third world nations. There are rules, but they don't seem to apply too much. And, you know, I said, what does all these paint on the road mean? It means they had paint. You know, it didn't mean a whole lot. And if you have no guidelines, you're going to have chaos. I cannot imagine driving from here to the airport if there were no highway rules. Can you imagine? I don't even know that I want to go to Plumville on that case. But, you know, there are rules in place in every arena, whether it be loading and unloading an airplane or the way that you wait your turn in line, even at the gas pump, those kinds of things. It is necessary to prevent chaos and catastrophe. If there were no standards of building, you wouldn't want to be sitting in a structure like this. And, you know, that's the reason why some of the countries that experience earthquakes have such casualties, because they have no standards for building. And if you think it'll hold, and, well, I guess it won't hold anymore. And then it collapses. But there are, and I can understand that they can be excessive and they can be overbearing and frustrating and all those kinds of things. But it is necessary that you submit yourselves to the ordinances of man. They are there for your good. They should be there for your good. And they should be there for your protection and safety and, you know, for the well-being of mankind. I understand it gets abused and it gets corrupted, because anywhere that man is involved, there's going to be that. Because there is human nature, there is unbelievers, there are ungodly people doing things, and that's the way it is. But that does not eliminate the believer's responsibility to do what is right, so long as it doesn't supersede God's command. When it supersedes God's command or the Holy Spirit's conviction and guidance in your life, then you're out of bounds, and you'll have to deal with that. And, you know, I'm not the judge, jury, or verdict, or nothing like that. God is the one in charge of that. So there are rules in place. What is the reason we should submit to those? It says, for the Lord's sake, for testimony, for if you are a believer, you should be willing to conform to, so long as. And there are times when you can't. Back to our three Hebrew children who did not bow down to the image, but yet they were still respectful to the king. O king, nevertheless, if we perish, we perish, but our God is able to deliver us. There was still a respect that Paul had when he faced the authorities, but yet he took the stand. And Peter the same. They were willing to face the problem with respect, but yet not give in to their, you know, disobey their conscience or disregard their Christian with their walk with the Lord. So you have the reason is for God, the Lord's sake, and you do what is right and he guides you to do. Then there are those that are in power. In this verse 14, it says, the end of 13, the king is supreme, or the governors were sent to enforce the laws, which is, in our setting, we have a president, we have law officers, we have military, and they all ought to be respected. They all ought to be treated as they're representing the laws of this land. And you know, you ought to be careful, and I know in every institution, in every church, in every home, in everything where man is, there's corruption, but that does not negate our responsibility as individuals to do what is right and to be respectful. And I'll just say, you know, when we were growing up, our parents made sure that we respected the authorities. You didn't give them names. You didn't call them unkind words or refer to them loosely. You said that is a police officer or that is a soldier in the military. You didn't call anybody slang or nicknames that were derogatory because of respect. And I think we need some more of that. We've lost respect in this land. We've lost patriotism. And I'll tell you, just because you fly a flag, you're not a radical. No, you're a patriot, and you are thankful for those that gave the ultimate price for our freedoms, and you don't need to bow under that. And we're in a culture that's playing too many cards that aren't true just to push their agendas. And you need to use discernment in that avenue and ask God to give you guidance of how to respond respectfully, truthfully, with grace. And that puts the big shoes on, and it's hard to know what to do. And I don't have pat answers, and I don't always pass the test. But there comes times that you just have to do as God leads you to do. But don't ever lose the respect and disappoint or cause disgrace to the cause of Christ, because you'll regret that, and it's not right. So there are rulers in power. We have our priorities or chain of command, whatever you want to call it. The institution of liberty came from individuals who are willing to stand up for what is right, to be willing to risk their life in criticism and rejection and ostracized and all those kinds of things, because they wanted to found this nation upon the truths and the guidance of God. And when there's definitely an influence and a strategy to eliminate that, but when you remove God from this nation, you're going to head to catastrophe. And as we see it, we're paying prices for that. And when you ignore God, he has to take action. And the consequences are always, if you sow to the flesh, you're going to reap corruption. If you sow to the Spirit, you reap life everlasting. That's a principle of Scripture that still applies. We ask God to bless America, but we want to do it our way. When we want him to bless it, we do it his way. And we need to issue this respect to the authorities that are in play. Second thing of liberty is verses 15 and 16. When you do what is right, and you respect those that are in authority, what do you see that is, according to the first part of 15? It's the will of God. It's not what I'm saying. It's not what, you know, that Peter's telling you. This is God's will. And if you do that, and by doing this good, you may put to silence the ignorance and foolishness of men. So the foolishness of men are those that disrespect the authorities. There's a lot of foolishness going on throughout our land. The foolishness is standing for a cause that isn't even a cause, it's an agenda, and it's evil, and they're doing things causing catastrophe and destruction upon innocent people, and disregarding and abusing the liberties that they have been given because they have an evil agenda, their ungodliness. This is happening in our land, and it's not right, and you know what? As believers, we need to pray about that. We need to seek God's face and ask for him to intervene, because he's going to have to do it, but it doesn't give us the right to participate. And you know, I'm totally against militia behavior. I am totally against right causes doing wrong things. You don't need to react in destruction. You don't need to react in a unorganized, chaotic protest. That's just wrong. You have the freedom of speech. You have the freedom to express yourself, but you have the also a responsibility to be pleasing to your Father and to represent what a Christian does. Do you think these early Christians appreciated what these Neros and leaders of the country were doing in Rome? No, they were heavily taxed. They were treated wrongly. They were abused and persecuted. And the apostles were being killed because of their belief in Christ. But yet they were still respectful and honored God. And we can do the same thing. So the implementation is that it's the will of God by our works and by doing good and by our words that you may silence their foolishness. Not only is it the will of God, it is the way of God. Verse 16 says that there's a condition that we are like. There's constraints and there's a choice. The condition is you are free. Do you know what? You are free when you do that. You can look people in the face and know that you treated them right. You can know that you've done right regardless of the evil accusations or behavior that they have participated in. There is a condition. When you are free indeed, as we saw in John chapter 8 last week. Then not only is there a condition, there's a constraint. Not using your liberty as a cloak for vice. That is when we get reckless with our forgiveness. And that God is the God who is compassionate and kind. We do not have a license to sin. And that was a problem. They were getting into excessive living and their attitudes and behavior were not pleasing to God. And Paul condemns it and Peter condemns it. We do not, as believers in Christ, we're forgiven, but we're not released to do our own thing. We are set under the leadership of the Holy Spirit. When you surrender your life to Christ, what is surrender? You give it over to. I'm going to do what you say. When you get a total unconditional surrender, you are submitting yourself to another authority. As believers, you're submitting yourself to who? To God. And you know what? He has your best in mind. And he has the best prepared for you. And he has right things and a future and a hope. And all the things that you can't even... He has blessings that you haven't even tapped into. You say, why do you know that? Because it says, eye has not seen nor ear have heard, or either has entered into the heart of man, all the things that he has prepared for them that trust in him. We have not because we ask not. And I'm not talking about a prosperity gospel. I'm talking about stuff that you should be asking for. The wisdom, the protection, the healing, the direction, the guidance, the timing. Do you ever ask God to provide the right timing for a situation? If you have and you're like me and you did and it happened, you get amazed. Why would he care enough to do that? But he does. His timing, you can't even orchestrate events like that. My wife and I were out one morning exercising together, and his timing was, I told Deb after that, there is no way there is anyone can tell me that God doesn't orchestrate events of life. You cannot do timing like God does timing. And you know, when you trust him and ask him to do it, don't be surprised. Give him praise. Why does that happen in verse 9? That you might proclaim the praises of him. It's to God be the glory, as the last word you saw on that song. It's not to give any praise to yourself or anything in our mentality or our choosing. It's to give it to him. So you have the constraints. We do not have this free pass. As you play Monopoly, get out of jail free card. Well, it's just not there. You need to be surrendered to his will and his way. Lastly is our choice, and that's where the bondservant comes into play. That was a choice, that you are bondservants of God. Let me tell you, that's a good place to be when you're following him as your master. Last point of the message is the ideals of liberty, and that comes from verse 17. And it's those four points. And how do you get around it? An ideal is existing as a perfect example. If you really are free and you really are liberated, what's the first thing you will do? Verse 17. Show respect, honor all people. Do you know your race doesn't supersede any race? And your background isn't any better than anyone else's. We all live and breathe and have our moving through him who has created us. We are on the ground is level at the foot of the cross. There's nobody stands higher on any platform. Oh, I'm here because of... No, they're not. You are there because of the grace of God. You are there because he loved you. You are there in his compassion and his mercy. And you know, we ought to be appreciative. There is not anything that supersedes, you know, you or me as individuals. There, we are to honor all people. Honor is something that you can put into play even if you don't agree. The Bible says, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Children have an obligation to obey regardless, because they are under the domain of that parent. They're in their household. This is what they want. This is what they get. Honor can come when you disagree with, but yet you still respect and care for. And that, I see that in come into play the older you get in life, when your parents you think are losing their minds and they act certain ways that you don't like, or they do things that you don't appreciate, you can still give honor. Honor doesn't mean you agree with, but you can get along with, and you can at least pray for, so much as lieth within you. We have a call to do that, to honor all people. Do I respect, do I appreciate the way that they worship and what they do in their cultures? No, but you can honor it. You can not say derogatory things. You can keep your thoughts to yourself and dismiss those ones that aren't right. But honor is something that has been an ongoing problem. Why did Jonah not want to go to Nineveh? It wasn't the boat ride he was afraid of or anything like that. He didn't like the people. He didn't want to go. But God, you made him go anyhow. And he turned the people around. And you know what? We don't have the right to be prejudiced. James deals with that harshly. So honor all people. What's the second thing we got to do? Love the brotherhood. Who's that? Fellow believers, love one another. Do you know that's a sad thing when Christians won't love other Christians? It's a really sad thing. And beyond that, we're called to love our enemies. That's a big step. And you know what? When you get to loving one another, that involves unity. That involves appreciation. You're not like anyone else in this place. You are you, and you are created to be you. There are things that God's working on in your life the same way he is in everybody else. But that calls us to love one another, to have the unity and the beauty in the body of Christ. Diverse, but yet beautiful. Aren't you glad that you aren't just like everybody else? They say that opposites attract. And you think about your own relationships, if you were attracted to someone opposite or not, I don't know. But I can tell you it works out better than if you're the same. Because if you're the same, it gets to be redundant and irritating real quickly. When you have someone who is an introvert with someone who is another introvert, you might not have any conversation at all. But if you, and then if you get the vice of, just talk to my wife, she'll tell you she's glad we're opposites. And that works out. Love the brotherhood. Third thing we got to do is fear God, reverence him. Take his name as holy. He is the creator of the world. Don't take it in vain. The Bible says he will not hold those guiltless that takes his name in vain. Respect who he is. He is God Almighty. He is the authority. And you can't be careful with the loose terminology. That's just advice from me. That's not, you know, I'm not the judge and I'm not going to correct you. But the remarks that we were often chastised for, we only ever said it once, he's not the man upstairs. He is God. We didn't dare say things like that. We come in a tough family. I understand that, but I appreciate that. It helped keep a little bit of respect in the belfry. All right, fear God. Last thing. You know, Proverbs 1:7, King Solomon says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. So when you fear God, that's a good start. Last thing, what are we to do? Honor the king. We don't have a king. We have a president. You still have to honor the office whether you like him or not. And whether next administration, whoever that is, you got to honor the office whether you like him or not, or her. We got a next administration, next one, if it so holds on, because democracies are about at their peak in demise after about a couple centuries. But nonetheless, wherever God puts you, you are called to honor and respect. That doesn't necessarily mean be on the same page, but it does mean take the high road. And it does mean to do what is right. Lastly, is a quote that I borrowed from Warren Wiersbe. As Christians, we must exercise discernment in our relationship to human government. There are times when the right thing is to set aside our own privileges, and there are other times when using our citizenship is the right thing. Seek God for wisdom and guidance. Apostle Paul used his citizenship when he had to. And there are times when you might have to hold on to rights that you've been given because of the Constitution of the United States. And you're allowed to hold on to them. But there are times when you have to say, I have this right and I'm allowed to use it, but I'm not going to. And you don't say a word. And you just deal with it. Let the Holy Spirit guide you when that is. And he'll give you the grace and the words you need to in that moment. And that's the struggle that we face, is that discernment. So we need to approach God for the wisdom and know how to handle situations that you don't understand or appreciate. I hope that it's been encouraging you that you are liberated in Christ, free forever. You know what? As believers, this isn't our home anyhow. We are not citizens here. We are citizens of heaven. This is just where our pilgrimage happens. Our journey, our opportunities. Who in your life do you need to be that testimony to? And show them the way. The way is Jesus. And the way to eternal life is through him. That's our calling. Our calling is not to purify the world in which we live. It's to purify ourselves, to live in this world. And God will do the matter, take care of those kinds of things. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the encouragement that it gives us. Help us to apply it and to be discerning when we should say something and when we shouldn't. When we should hold on to rights that have been granted, when we should forfeit them for the benefit of others. Help us to be discerning. Help us to be bright lights in a dark world. Thank you, God, that you promised to take care of us, to provide for us, and eventually call us into your presence. Lord God, if there's anyone that don't know you as Lord and Savior, may they take this as their chance to ask you to forgive their sin and be the Lord of their life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.